do what we can do. If the Lord don't get in it, we'll shut up and go home and go sleep, I guess. Amen. Philippians chapter 4, verse 4, since we're all sleepy. Amen. I didn't take my nap today. I don't get naps on Sunday. Can I get back over here and study and try to get my mind where it needs to be? Hear from heaven. But I believe the Lord can help us in the midst of our tired bodies and refresh us, and minister to us. He remembers we're but dust. That's what the Bible says, dust of the earth. Earth. And realize we're just flesh, but yet he loves us and wants to minister to us. Philippians 4 and 4. I was going to preach this morning, but the Lord directed otherwise. The Bible says, rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I say rejoice. Rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I say rejoice. I want to preach this evening, however long the Lord will allow, on rejoice. Rejoice. I believe we need to hear this. Rejoice. Rejoice. Amen to God. Let's pray. Father, I ask you to touch us tonight in a special way. God, you can come right in the middle of this service right now and make it alive. I pray, God, for your anointing to preach this glorious gospel. Minister to this place. We humbly confess we need you. And we're nothing without you, and apart from you, God, we can do nothing. God, help us tonight to have an ear to hear and a heart to receive this good word of God. Season our speech tonight. Give us that tongue of the learned. In Christ's name, we pray for the anointing to break and destroy the yoke of bondage. That there be liberty to worship, to pray, to receive from heaven what you'd have us to receive tonight. In Jesus' name, we pray. And we thank you for it. Amen. And amen. You love the Lord tonight? Amen. Rejoice and say amen. 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 Rejoice. When I think of the word rejoice, I think of joy being expressed. Because you can have joy in your heart, joy in your soul, but joy causes you to rejoice. I believe rejoicing is an outward expression of an inward experience and an inward joy that only comes from heaven. And if we are lacking that part, then we will be lacking rejoicing night and day as I walk this gospel way. In the world, there's a lot of sadness and a lot of bad news, and it seems like that we just don't have nothing to rejoice about. And that's for the world. But in the midst of an upside-down world, you can have, amen to God, a genuine experience with Jesus Christ and have something to rejoice about. And that's the Lord of glory. There is no peace, no hope, or reason to rejoice in this world. I mean, you know, people have temporary happiness because of things that happen. But they don't have everyday eternal joy in their soul outside of Jesus Christ. John 6:16-33 says, these things have I spoken unto you, that you might have peace. In the world you shall have tribulation, but be of good cheer, I have overcome the world. 1 Corinthians 15:19 says, if we have hope only in this life, we are all men most miserable. I hate to know all I was living for was what was down here. What was temporal, what was tangible, what I could see. Amen. Just to get up and go to work on a Monday morning and slave to Friday and wait for the weekend for something that we had planned to happily to make us happy because of the circumstance of whatever we had planned. Then as soon as that's over, it seemed like we're just back in the old grind again. But no matter what is going on in the midst of this world, every Christian should have true joy that brings forth rejoicing in our heart in our lives. The world, the sinners have nothing to rejoice about. I mean, you think they expend all they can just to build up themselves and live for only this life and have not hope past this life. Therefore, outside of Christ, there's no true life and no true peace and no true joy. But I've seen it right in the church. I've seen it right in the Christendom. I've seen it right in the midst of believers. It seems like they have nothing to rejoice about. All they want to do is look on the things that are going wrong, the things that are going south instead of things that are going good in our lives. But no matter what the situation is, whether it's good, whether it's bad, whether everything is going right or everything is going wrong, the Christian should still have joy that produces rejoicing in our lives. Amen to God. But all Christians should rejoice. There's sitting an hour to always be of sad countenance and always be low-hearted and low-spirited and full of unbelief and negativism. We need to have faith and joy and hope in our soul because of what God has done for us. I don't care what tomorrow holds. I still know who holds tomorrow. I don't care, amen to God, what comes my way, if it's the worst news or the best news. It doesn't change what Christ has done for me. Amen to God. It doesn't change that my name is in the Lamb's Book of Life. And therefore, God's people should always be rejoicing along this Christian way. Deuteronomy 12 and 6 tells us through 7 that they were to bring their tithe thither. You bring your burnt offerings and your sacrifice and your tithes and your offerings of your hand and your vows and your freewill offering and the firstling of your herd and of your flocks. And there shall you eat before the Lord your God. You shall rejoice in all that you put in your hand unto ye and your household, wherein the Lord thy God has blessed thee. You know, the church should be a place of refuge. It should be a place of haven. When we was up in the mountains, we went up to Cave's Cove. We went through there and we was just goo-goo, ga-ga over all the deers that we saw. And I was wishing the whole time I had a rifle in my hand. I could have packed that meat up in the cooler and brung it home. But, you know, I couldn't do it. We just goo-goo and ga-ga because it was a refuge. They would walk right out in front of you and they know they weren't going to get shot. Amen. You could be from here to that plant over there and take a picture of them. They just stood up and look at you like, get out. This is my place. This isn't yours. Because they know it was the refuge. But you go in the woods somewhere and get that close and they will just blow and they go. I'm here to tell you right now. Why? Because it was their refuge. It was a place of habitat. It was a place of security. And that's what the church should be every time we come here. We come here to give sacrifice. We come here to give our vows and our commitments to God. We've come here to give our tithes and our offerings of our hands unto the Lord our God and be thankful and rejoice wherein the Lord has blessed us. I don't know about you, but He has blessed me. He has blessed me abundantly. He has blessed me above blessings. I don't deserve the blessings that He has blessed me with. All I've done is come to church and paid my tithes and given the offerings, amen to God, and pay my vows unto the Lord that I've committed my ways in my heart and just begin to rejoice in the blessings of God. I don't have nothing to rejoice about. When you're here tonight, you've got breath in your body. You're not at the hospital. You're not in the prison nowhere. And God give you strength, and therefore we should give praises unto Him who has blessed me. David knew the strength of this when he said, bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me. Bless His holy name. He knew the power of blessing God because of what God had done for him. Even when he was running from Absalom and Shimei was cursing him, he said, leave him alone. Maybe the Lord will turn this into a blessing. I'm here to tell you, my friend, if you put God first and you give to God, God will bless you. He'll bless you abundantly. He'll bless you, amen, to God, above measure, that there wouldn't even be room to contain it, because He is a divine blesser. And when God's people learn to bless the blesser, blessings will continue to come. And when God's people learn to bless the blesser, and joy will fill our heart, and therefore there will be rejoicing in our spirit, rejoicing in our walk, rejoicing in our attitude. You know why? Because we've learned the power of blessing the blesser, who healeth all my diseases, who forgiveth all my iniquities. iniquities. Hallelujah to God who tappeth, amen, puts me in the presence of the enemy and sets my own table there and lets me feast in the midst of the devil's den and said, hey, I'm God's property. You can't touch me because I've been bought by a price. I've been purchased by the Lamb. I have been redeemed, and therefore I think I will just rejoice. Amen. Psalms 5 and 11 says, but let all those that put their trust in thee rejoice. Who are you trusting in? You trusting in man? You trusting in social security? You trusting in the government? You trusting in your job? I'm here to tell you, all that can be yanked out from underneath you tomorrow. I've been hearing all my life, Social Security won't be there for me when I get there. Well, I know who will be there for me, and therefore I will rejoice. Hallelujah to God. Let the man that trusts in the Lord rejoice. I don't know about you, but it's better to trust God than it is man. It's better to put your confidence in God than it is man. And when you've got this confidence and this trust, you can't help but to lift up your hands. You can't help but to say hallelujah. You can't help but to say praise the Lord. Because I know who my blessings come from. It don't come from man, but it comes from above. I know who my salvation has come from. It's come from above and not from man. And therefore I think I will rejoice in my salvation. Yeah. Woo! Don't let your salvation get stale. Don't let it get old. Don't let it get stagnant. But you keep joy bubbling in your soul. And let the expression of rejoicing be in your life each and every day. I don't care what you're going through. If your body's aching, if your back's sore, if your head's sore, praise God anyways. You know why? Because the devil can keep you from praising God by getting your body sick. He'll keep you sick every day of your life. But if you can say, devil, you're not going to steal my joy, you're not going to steal my hope, you're not going to steal my peace, and you're not taking away my privilege of rejoicing in my God. I'm not rejoicing in the church, I'm not rejoicing in man, but I'm going to rejoice in the Lord always. And again I say rejoice. What you talking about, Paul? He said you rejoice in God, you rejoice in your salvation, you give glory to God. Woo! Thank you, Lord, for stopping by and helping us a little while. Amen. Blessed are all those who put their trust in thee. And let all those that put their trust in thee rejoice. Let them shout for joy. Why? Because I know whom I have believed in. And I'm persuaded he's able to keep that which I committed unto him against that day. I fought a good fight. I kept the faith and went forth this letter for me a crown of righteousness, but not for me only, but all those that love the Lord and look to his appearing. Amen. Timothy, you be faithful. You do the working of evangelists. You show full proof of your ministry and you just rejoice along the way. The devil will try to stop you. People will persecute you, but you keep on shouting joy and you keep on rejoicing. Amen. Woo! Because thou defendest them. Who's fighting your battles? I don't know about you, but if you'll back up, God will fight your battles. Wrath of man worketh not the righteousness of God. One preacher friend, of course he's not in the church now because he lets things get the best of him. But things happen and that shouldn't have happened, and member and preacher bulked up in each other's face. He said, I felt the grace to walk away, but I didn't want to. And when I hit him, amen, all heaven stood off away from me. But if I'd have walked away, God would have fought my battles. I'm here to tell you, you don't have to fight spiritual battles and fight people with your fist and your mouth and your attitude. But if you walk away gracefully, I'm talking about a God that will defend you. A God that will take all of heaven on his side and tear down every stronghold of hell. I thank God I got one that defends my camp. I mean to tell you, I got to take care of my family. If a man comes in my house over there to kill my family, I promise you he'll have to go through me. I got a 357 over there.